serve not only Wilsonville, but we serve the Tualatin Park and Ride. We go up to the Barber Boulevard Transit Center. We go into Canby, and we go as far south as Salem, all with our fixed route service. I'm the Director of Operations. I've been in the business for 36 years. I started when I was 10. But I've been with SMART since 1995. And when I got there, I was a consultant to help put the system together. It withdrew from TriMet in 1988 and began operations in 1989. When I got there, it was mostly a little dial-a-ride system with a couple of routes, and we've turned it into a nice transit system for not only Wilsonville residents, but for those who work in Wilsonville, which outnumber the residents. Wilsonville has about 18,000 residents, and the workers that come into Wilsonville as a numbers about 20,000 every day. So SMART is not only a commuter service for our workers, but we also have our demand response service and our local service for the residents of Wilsonville. The handouts that I handed out, or that you picked up, the one that shows SMART's evolution is one that shows the history of SMART and where we are today. As you can see, I mentioned 1988 and 89 was when SMART started. When I came here in 1994 as a consultant, we were carrying about 3,500 rides a month. We now carry about 33,000 rides a month. So we've grown quite significantly. Our main revenue source is the payroll tax that businesses pay, similar to TriMet, in fact, just like TriMet. We charge a little less for the businesses, and they like that. TriMet is up over 0.7%, and we're at 0.5%. So a little bit lower rate, and one of the reasons why Wilsonville got out of the TriMet district is they felt that they weren't getting the bang for the buck. And so when we put the system together, we gave them what TriMet had was that it had one commute service route into Wilsonville. And when we put the system together, we had we built five routes, and today we have seven routes. So as you can see, the residents and the employees of Wilsonville have benefited by withdrawing from TriMet. I know we have some ex-TriMet employees here, so I can't badmouth them too much. But we do have a very good working relationship. When they make service changes, they are they tell us so that we can respond and continue to connect with them very well. One of the highlights of my career here at SMART was the instituting of the West Service, the West Side Express commuter train service. It's not light rail. How many people here have taken West around from between Beaverton and Wilsonville? It's not a light rail. It's a heavy commute rail, just like other big cities in the Bay Area and New York and places like that. So when they came to Wilsonville, we completely redesigned our service so that we came up with what is called the 10-minute plan. If you get off the train, you can go just about anywhere in Wilsonville in 10 minutes or less. And that's been very popular. It's helped increase the ridership. It's a seamless transition. We recognize that a lot of people don't like to transfer between buses or other systems, and so we made it as seamless as possible, and it seems to have worked and is appreciated not only by the employees, but also by the employers who pay the payroll tax. The other handout that I have is the Transit Master Plan. It's not the complete master plan. That's about 150 pages, but I did glean the highlights of this plan. Again, it kind of tells a little bit about the history and where we're going, what we would like to do, and such as that. Excuse me. So if ever you do come into Wilsonville, either by our buses or by the West Train or by Line 96 of TriMet, the city of Wilsonville is a fare free zone. So you don't need to pay an extra fare when you get off of TriMet or the West, as long as you're staying within Wilsonville. So you could move about freely without having to buy a day pass or worrying about getting a transfer or anything like that. Once you leave Wilsonville, we do have fares up to Portland. It's $1.25. Also, to Cambie is $1.25. And if you wanted to go to Salem, it's $2.50. If you buy a pass because you're a commuter, it's substantially lower, to where a one-way ride is all the way to Salem is about $1.67. You cannot drive your car for $1.67 between Wilsonville and Salem. So it's a very good deal. Hurry up. It won't last long. We're in negotiations with Salem Transit that also provides some of the 1X service to look at changing the fares on that. We do have a new city council that is pro-business, and so they hold our feet to the fire to make sure that the businesses that are paying the tax are getting their money's worth. And if they feel that they're not, then I have to go in front of them and explain why. So one of the things that they were looking at is, why is the fare between Salem and Wilsonville so cheap? And I say, well, we instituted that in 2006, and we haven't changed it since. So they are telling me in a little bit of slang language, you might say, that it's time to look at the fares. So we'll be doing that. But where we're going, what we would like to do is expand our service into downtown Portland. Right now, as I mentioned, that we stop at the Barber Boulevard Transit Center, and that people have to transfer to the 12 to get all the way to downtown. And I've always felt that that's kind of shortchanging the riders, because they don't get to where they're going. They can't get to where they're going on SMART. We'd like to serve Portland State and downtown. Of course, that would cost about $500,000 a year or more to do so, and money is, of course, the center of the universe when it comes to serving the public and providing service. So that probably will be put on hold. We were planning to increase our payroll tax to at least 0.6% rather than 0.5%, and that would help pay for it. But with the recession and things like that, it would not be good for businesses, and it certainly would not be good to ask for it at this time. So that's on hold, but we are still looking at other ways to increase our service around town. There's some new developments in Wilsonville. One is a great big housing project called Billwalk, and we have token service to that area. We'd like to have it more than just token service, so that people can get around more easily rather than just waiting for a few trips. So that's where we are today, and I don't want to take up ride connection part of it, so I'm going to turn over the podium to them, and then after they speak, then we'll have opportunities to ask questions and answer them, hopefully. So thank you very much.
Just in case. I was just telling And today, we have over 30 partners. And they are people like American Red Cross, Metropolitan Family Service, can be Adult Center, Lake Oswego Adult Center, the Hollywood Senior Center. People that we can help with basically scheduling services. We have an in-house scheduling and call center. And we also help out with funding. A lot of our funding comes from state and federal contracts, government contracts. So with that comes a lot of reporting requirements and a lot of stuff like that. So what we can, what we do as Ride Connection is we help coordinate and provide that service. So last year alone, we provided over 416,000 rides, which is pretty amazing in the Tri-County area. And we also travel trained 223 people. And I'll get to travel training in a little bit. So that's just a little bit of history about us. And now I'm just going to talk a little bit about our programs. One of our most used services is the door-to-door, or also known as demand response transit. So we have people call in at least 4 days before an appointment and request a ride, and then we work to schedule that. We have about 700 drivers in the network. Two-thirds of those are volunteers. So it takes us a little bit to schedule, and then once we have that ride, once we know that we've got someone to do the ride, we'll call that person back 2 days ahead of time just to let them know to confirm or deny the ride. Not all of our rides are guaranteed, unfortunately. We provide service for this Monday through Friday, basically business hours, 8 to 5. And there is no charge, which is it's an important thing for a lot of people who are on fixed income and can't afford a transit. So we gladly accept donations, but we do not charge. As Steve stated, money is at the center of transit, transportation. And I suppose now is a good time as any to go over our funding. We do basically get the bulk of our funding from state government and federal government. We do also rely on grants. We apply for grants quite a bit and individual donations. And then our volunteers are priceless. The amount the amount of capital, well, not capital, but their worth is more than their weight in gold. So in addition to our door-to-door service, we do community shuttles. We have about six of these running in different neighborhoods throughout the Tri-County area. And they're where we see a need for, where we see a lot of requests coming in for grocery stores in a particular neighborhood. What we've done is implemented a shuttle so that we're, instead of doing individual rides to and from, we're doing loops. We stop at residences and go to Fred Meyer or Trader Joe's, common destinations that people share. So those are really great. Those are really efficient for us, and they're also I've been on a few. They're really fun. They can be a real social thing as well. And then here, near here, we have the community bus service. That is something that we implemented for general public. Basically, we saw a need for, there was a gap in TriMet service, in Banks, Forest Grove, you guys know the area, Cornelius, where people weren't being served by TriMet or any other service. So the community bus is mainly for commuters. We have a morning and an afternoon route. It basically goes from Forest Grove to Banks to North Plains to Hillsboro. And I hope I'm right, and Elise is nodding, but yes, that's right. And basically it provides a way to get to at the very least, the Hillsboro Transit Center, so that people can connect with TriMet and get into downtown, and so people can actually live in Forest Grove without a vehicle. So that's a lot about the services that are provided in mini buses and minivans and volunteer-owned vehicles. But we also have this really fantastic program called RideWise, where we teach people how to ride public transportation. it's really great for people who are willing and ready to go, or not quite ready, to go out on transit. People sometimes face cognitive or physical barriers and just need maybe a little help or a lot of help to get to the point where they can ride transit safely and independently. So that was the program where we exited 223 individuals last year. So those are people that can now get to work or can get to a volunteer opportunity because, and they can do it on their own because they went through our training. So that is really neat. And this is kind of about it, about the services. I could talk about so much more. We have a veterans program that we specifically serve veterans, currently running in Multnomah and Washington counties here. Basically, what I'd like you to leave with is that we provide a lot of options, primarily for people 60 and over and for people with disabilities. But when we see a need, we would like to fill it. I mean, our mission is to link accessible transportation with community need. So we're really just hoping to be able to fill in the gaps where we can and make sure that everyone has access to transportation. And I just have one more order of business. I'd like to introduce Elise Brewer. She's our transportation manager in Washington County, so she's located in Forest Grove. So
I'm pretty new. I just started the job a month ago, but I coordinate Ride Connections program out in Western Washington County. So I'm still learning the program, but I live in the area, and so I'm familiar with the people and the needs of the area. And Ride Connection is offering a really great service, and I'm really glad to be a part of this company.
Smart operates, then now's the time to raise your hand.
water for a member. The whole problem with our economy obviously must affect everybody, no matter who you are, either it's local revenue or could be grants and so on. Could you explain how that factor is affecting what you can do?
Well, one of the things that we've done to combat our decreasing funding sources is that we've taken a really big step in the last three years, to educate our legislators about what we're doing and the need for it. So we spent a lot of work compiling information and making sure that our legislators get that information. We also have taken people down to Salem for Transit Day, where we can actually have a bunch of our riders meeting with their representative in order to tell them of the need. And so spreading awareness really helps us make sure that we're securing those funding sources year after year. It's one of the things. We also beg sometimes.
and for SMART, Wilsonville has a lot of big corporations in it. We have Xerox, we have Mentor Graphics, we have Cisco, we have several big, I'd say the Big Ten probably contributes 80% of our payroll tax. With the economy that tanked for a few years, yes, we did see the declining revenue. Also, one of the grants that we used never for operating because we knew that it may go away one day, and it has, was called BETSY, the Business Energy Tax Credit. We used that to buy buses and other capital projects that we needed. These were one-time expenses that prevented us from relying on day-to-day operations. I have cut $114,000 out of last year's budget. So we have taken steps to meet the declining revenues. The $114,000 was invisible to the public. Is more materials and services and nothing as far as a service to the public. But also at the same time, with those declining, the businesses have been rebounding and the payroll tax has actually gone up in the past 2 years. So that has prevented us from making other drastic cuts. If that were to happen, probably we would reallocate some of our resources into a stronger service at the expense of a weaker service, but again, we would be more efficient in spending the tax dollars more wisely.
time at about 29, 29.50, might be a little bit more right now, to provide a one-way Lyft ride. And Ride Connection can do that for about 14.50. That was our average cost per ride last year. So in a way, we are more limited in our service than TriMet Lyft is. We don't operate the same hours or the same, mainly hours. But what we do is we help people that might be riding Lyft get around. So any person that rides with us is technically someone who is not on the Lyft system. So if we can help someone with our service, we will do that. Does that answer your question sufficiently?
You know, you mentioned Wes, and is that competing with Smart? And I can say, no, it's not. First of all, Wes was designed to get the commuters off of Highway 217 and also Highway 8 and 10 and 26. Right now, the Wes is carrying about, 1,800 riders a day. So if you divide that by two, and it's usually less than that, but just for argument's sake, they were able to take 900 to 1,000 cars off the road, then they have been successful in their objective. We don't compete with the West because they are coming from Beaverton, and our desire to go to downtown is in a different direction. So they actually complement one another. If you were to come from Salem and get to downtown, you would take our bus if we had one, rather than Wes. If you were wanting to go to Beaverton or Hillsboro, then of course you wouldn't take our bus. You would take the Wes commuter train. So again, it's a complimentary service that helps the entire area getting out of their cars and providing less congestion on the freeways.
Dolores Raymond, forum member. I have been volunteering for over 20 years, beginning back in 1985, primarily focused on housing and transportation for seniors with disabilities. One of the best things I have ever done as a volunteer was as a member of Ride Connection's board of directors. And I met your guiding star, Elaine Wells, early on. I think one of the best things that Ride Connection does is to serve rural areas that TriMet doesn't go, since they conform to ADA guidelines. And I haven't driven for over 3 years, ever since I had a small stroke, and I'm not willing to put anybody at risk, but Ride Connection is currently getting me to my doctor's office, which I greatly appreciate. So I think Ride Connection is wonderful, and I enjoy serving on their development committee. I'm very familiar with that wonderful organization.
Thank you. Thank you for all your help.
Mark Freiberg, forum member. This is for both our speakers regarding your public service for the general public in various communities. And that is, what is it about your economies that make it economical, cost-effective for you to serve areas where TriMet cannot? I'm curious, because sometimes the smaller guys have more trouble doing that.
Well, a lot depends on the union contract. TriMet has a contract that is probably much more expensive, that causes the drivers are paid more. They have probably better and more long-lasting benefits, and such as this. So when you compare what TriMet has to dole out, so to speak, in terms of providing the service in labor and such as that, then the cost will certainly be much more higher than if a small city can avoid paying a driver, say, $25 an hour and instead pay them $12 an hour. If their benefit package is less generous, University in TriMet's hourly figures of around $100, between $97 and $107 an hour. SMART's hourly costs are about between $65 and $85. So when you add them up with all the labor costs and things like that, yes, the big transit systems are usually more costly than the smaller ones.
My answer will be a little more simple because I just don't know that in-depth information, but I will tell you that with our community bus, the public service that we provide, we have experience in planning service, especially in smaller areas, and when with the community bus in particular, we're running that at the heaviest at the peak times. So, you know, we're not mandated to do a certain thing. We're basically, we saw a need and we found a way to fill it the best we could with our funding. And a lot of the times, we can seek specific funding for specific projects, things that are sitting there and ready to go if we've got the right solution for it. So in us, it becomes a little less expensive when we're running the bus in the mornings and just the afternoons, and we're not running an empty bus in the middle of the day. So I know that that helps.
Bruce Bartlett, former member. I live in unincorporated Washington County, and there's been a lot of discussion about your work with cities, but given the highly ironic creation of the unincorporated areas, do you have a relationship, or what is your relationship with, how would we in the unincorporated area establish a relationship with Ride Connection, or are you in, do you sort of view the area independent of jurisdictional boundaries? Well, do you have relationships with specific cities, or do you deal with the area independent of what city boundaries are?
Sure. City boundaries don't necessarily apply to us. We are, like I said, we go where the need is. So what for the best way for you to get going with us is just have a conversation with us. That's how a lot of things start. We will meet someone networking, or service planners will see somebody out, and it all starts with one conversation. What are your needs? What's going on out there? Can you help us figure out what the demand is? How many people aren't being served? And that's how it all kind of starts. And then it just, next step is try to find funding for it. Where can we find the money? Can we work together to get some? Can we, so it all just kind of, I can get you a business card if you'd like to start some conversations.
Okay, because right now, the area north of Highway 26, which is the area that I'm most, I live there and am involved in land use activities in that area, and TriMet provides minimal service up there, and we have the Cedar Mill shuttle that runs at the commute times, but it's being cut back due to budget considerations. And I didn't know if there might be a way of augmenting that service, so I'd be really happy to get your contact information.
Great. Yeah, we'll pass it on. Just a great question.
Thanks.
Chris Leslie, former member. Since I know we have a lot of time, do you have any funny stories about what you do? I mean, I have a friend who avails himself of the service who's handicapped in the wheelchair, so he has to use the wheelchair. Things like that. I'm sure there's some funny stories there. I mean, Mr. Allen, with your name, which on the spot.
I don't have any funny stories off the top of my head, but if you had a piano, I'd be able to play it for you.
Anyway, it was really about how you help the disabled get out of their houses, and your system for helping with wheelchairs, things like this. What are the limits of the disabilities? I mean, anything like that.
So we have, at Ride Connection, we have about 100 vehicles in our fleet. Some of those are mini buses, like 15 passenger, and some of those are mini vans. And they're all lift equipped. And so those are ready and able to help anyone with any sort of mobility device, including a wheelchair. And for people who are not, who don't need that level of assistance, we have a lot of volunteers driving their own cars, which is really neat. But I will tell you that it's, I've been out on quite a few ride-alongs with our service, and our riders are always so appreciative of going where it is they need to go. I've been with someone who's gone to the Cascade Athletic Club for, you know, she goes twice a week for her exercise appointments. We've got someone visiting, someone who used to visit his wife in a care facility while he was at home, and then their situation's reversed, and now she goes to visit him in the care facility. So we help out so many different people in so many different ways.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Don Pullen, board member. Unlike a previous question, I'd never heard of you folks. How do you market yourself, particularly to get into unincorporated areas, people living out of the country? Let's assume that I was a disabled and I lived on a farm and so on. How are you marketing yourselves?
Also a good question. We market ourselves in many ways, and we use mainly grassroots code word for no-cost approaches. We love things like this, forums, groups, presentations. I'm out in the community a lot doing these types of presentations, and they're anywhere from medical support groups to neighborhood associations to I did one at the Tiger Library last week. Basically, presentations are a huge part. But we also work to get work with social service agencies. We work with hospitals to get brochures into hospital brochure racks. We try to use our press to get stories out in the paper. We've just recently started putting also volunteer here and campaigns on our buses, so we're trying to make ourselves more visible via our fleet that is out in the community.
And for SMART, you may or may not ever use it, but for those who do live and work in Wilsonville, we do attend the job fairs so that people who are at work, they come into maybe the lunchroom or wherever the job fair is, and they we have information along with some packets that we give them. A long time ago, back in the mid-90s, what we used to do is we actually had some radio advertising, some newspaper advertising, but now with the internet, it seems like people are on the internet surfing, and they're Googling everything. So we have a very good website, www.ridesmart.com, and people can get information there. And if for some reason their questions aren't answered on the web, then of course it gives a telephone number to call for additional information.
Jody Wise, informed member. So my question is about the economics of this. I'm with a group that's kind of a revenue watchdog, so I've noticed applications, for instance, with Connect Org. And my question would be, one, what are you asking for funds to do? And two, why should your riders ride for free rather than contributing something?
So the funding stuff, really, I'm going to say as much as I can about it. Not that we try to be private, but I don't want to give you the wrong information. We have an operating budget last year of $6.7 million. It's expensive. Transportation is expensive. We have so many different contracts. I think we had, I can't even speak to this, but we had quite a few contracts coming in. So it kind of depends. What we ask for is usually similar every year. We we apply for the same amount. If there is a specific need, like I talked about in rural Washington County, or if we see a specific need, we might go after a different amount of money for a special project, knowing what it's going to cost. Speaking to the whether or not we should charge a fare, I know for a fact that a lot of our riders are on fixed income, a lot, meaning that they really couldn't even afford a fare. I also know for a fact that we've got a lot of riders that could afford a fare. So I do think that there might be issue with charging some and not others. I haven't been in any discussions about charging a fare. I've been with Ride Connection for almost 4 years, and we've never batted around the idea of charging. So I can't tell you what has come out of those discussions early on.
As far as Wilsonville is concerned, we do have, as I mentioned, we do charge for out of town. One of the grants that we receive is a federal grant, it's called 5307, and it's based on the miles and the ridership numbers. If our ridership were to go down, then that grant funding would go down as well, which would put more burden on the local businesses. So we feel that by keeping Wilsonville city proper, fareless,
It seems like there's a possibility for synergy with school districts in providing rides for outlying kids into school or to replace school bus services. Do either of your services work with school districts?
Currently, we work with school districts on our RideWise program, where we have a train-the-trainer program, where we train teachers how to teach their children how to ride public transit. And we work with them quite a bit on going into classes and teaching students how to, we might bring a bus out, a non-service TriMet bus out to help them, orientate them with the system and stuff. But currently, we have not looked into expanding to the business idea.
In terms of providing school bus service, we are prevented by federal law from doing that.
That's a relief.
Well, the school bus drivers are trained more thoroughly in making sure the children are safe. They don't allow standees, public transit does. But we do work with the school districts in finding out what time they let out. And we have some routes that go by schools, and we'll time it so that the children who want to take SMART can do so to and from school. But it is not a school bus service. It's open to the general public, and it just happens to serve the school on this route. Now, what we do with the schools, we get them involved in SMART. We have what's called our SMART ART program, and what they do, the grade school and middle schools will draw pictures of transportation, whether it's trains or buses or carpooling or bicycles, skateboarding, and at the end of, or near the end of the first semester, we judge all these arts, and the winners will actually have their picture on our bus in terms of bus graphics, and we take them to the schools, show them off, and mom and dad and young artists can be very proud that their picture is on one of our buses.
The other comment is that school-age children don't actually know how to walk on streets that don't have sidewalks. And since there's a lot of sparsely connected sidewalks and gaps in the active transportation system, it's not as hilarious as it sounds like saying kids don't know how to walk, that walking into oncoming traffic and how to deal with sort of unregulated pedestrian activities. I was just thinking that it might be, in your training program, it might be helpful to train children how to navigate streets where there aren't sidewalks safely.
It is part of our RideWise. That is all part of our RideWise training. So when we talk about transit, we talk about all the things that go along with it, and safety is number one in priority in those conversations. And it does happen not just on the bus, but once you get off, and safe crossing and all of that. So it is part of our training.
I'm part of the citizen participation system in Washington County, and there's a monthly newsletter that goes out, and I don't know if you've put any information in the CPL newsletter, but it reaches 50,000 people, I think. So.
Can I?
Yeah.
I'm down with Lee, is that what you want? And I'm very, I think it's wonderful that you're talking about our community services, how people can get around. For our TV camera, which is recording for our public access, and also for our website, we'll be down in the link to the program. Do you also have phone numbers and email addresses for viewers so that they can get the information that way too?
Yes, sir. So, Pride Connection, if you're interested in service or finding out more about us, you can reach us at 503-226-0700. If you're a new customer with us, we'll ask you to register. It's just a few questions over the phone. It's really easy. I encourage you to call in. And you can also find us online at rideconnection.org, all one word, all lowercase. And we can be emailed at info@rideconnection.org.
And again, our website is www.ridesmart.com. Our phone number is 503-682-6700. 7790. And I want to make sure that people realize that SMART is not just a commute bus service. We do provide demand response service, not only within Wilsonville, but we have a $100,000 grant that provides medical appointments for elderly and disabled residents of Wilsonville to be able to go to doctor's appointments and medical centers all the way up to St. Vincent's, Providence, OHSU, and Veterans Hospital, amongst others. So that is a charge. It's only $2, but again, it has the community involved in helping pay for the service.
On behalf of everybody, I'd like to thank you for changing your name, because Ride Wart just wouldn't be quite the same.
When I first got here, I said, I'm glad I didn't start working for Fresno. So anyway, yes, Wart was kind of a little, it was fun when we first started. We had as a mascot a frog, of course, but we thought that it was a little bit too childish. And so Smart, we had actually had a contest, and a graphic artist came up with the word Smart, and we chose that. So I like it, and I think it does describe what we do with the South Metro Area Regional Transit System.
Are there any more questions? Okay. I want to thank all of you very, very much. This was really nice, and it's information now that if we didn't have, we have got. And if we had a little bit, we have a lot more. And I really, really appreciate this. This was really great. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Okay, well, as it goes, we are finished for today. Next week, we are going to have ODOT, which are about projects in our area, funding forecasts, future strategies. The two speakers at this point will be Kelly Brooks, ODOT Region 1, and David Kim, ODOT Area West Manager. So at this point, unless we have further information, have a great afternoon and evening. Thank you.